Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this memorial service for Travis Budinsky. Your presence today is the evidence of the special person that Travis was. He is one that was a beloved husband, a loving father, a treasured son, brother, and a friend. And your presence today shows your support and your heartfelt sympathies towards Kaylee and the Budinsky family today. Thank you for coming and being a part of this service and this afternoon as we remember Travis and celebrate his life together. There is one here today as well who knew Travis very well and could love Travis better than any of us ever could. And that was Travis's Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He was a person of great importance to Travis. And in looking for comfort today in this great loss, we look to the words of the Savior. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls." We want to take a moment to sing some songs that were precious to Travis, and so I invite you, as you're able to sing along this song of Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we pray. Always hunger for, oh, our hearts always hunger for. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. Always hunger for, oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. Our hearts always hunger for.
At this time, I'm going to read some poems that Kaylee has written. She has two, and I'll read these for you here this afternoon. How many songs have you sang with the angels? How many times has Jesus heard you laugh? Through the camera, though the camera made you bashful, have you taken heaven's photographs? Do you dance or sway with a melodious tune? Do you hold a trumpet in your hands? Is there sunshine like the days of June? Or can you frolic through the glorious land? Are there any kind, familiar faces? Was there a joyful meeting and family reunion? Did you stand in awe of how great the space is? You worship our Lord in present, but do you still have communion? Your peace must be ever present. Your cup must runneth over. I wonder if the small is pleasant and if the time is slower. Are you waiting our arrival? What things have you have made you smile? Can you see hell and all God's rivals? I'll see you soon, but grieve you in the meanwhile. I wonder what it's like up there, up on those streets of gold, to see God in all his glory and the majesty your eyes behold. I wonder what you look like and how you've taken form. I wonder what it's like up there to have no more grief or mourn. I wonder what it's like up there to feel no pain or sorrow, to always be rejoicing, never fret about the morrow. I wonder what it must be like to leave the earth behind and marvel at the mighty King and praise his name on high. I wonder what it's like up there to walk those streets of gold with the Lord who comforts you and leaves your heart consoled. And invite Pastor Roy Dowdy to come at this time and to commit this time to the Lord and lead our hearts in a time of prayer.
Before I pray, my heart goes out to Kaylee and her family, and it truly does. The years that I pastored, periodically I would have an evangelist come to our church. During one of those meetings, there was a blind, I believe this is where I learned this, there's a particular song. I'm just going to mention a couple of phrases on this song before I pray. But this particular evangelist was a blind man, played the piano, sang. He was a tremendous preacher. But the song that I learned at that particular time was called New Grace. The words of this song says this: all of grace is my story, all the way from earth to glory, since by grace he lifted me from sin and woe. And the chorus says this: grace not yet discovered, grace not yet uncovered, grace from his bountiful store, grace to cross the river, grace to face forever, there'll be a new grace I've not needed before. Father God, thank you for your wonderful grace that you have and bestow upon us. I pray that a young sister, Kaylee, and her family will be able to receive that grace. I know there's a lot of questions on their mind, the whys, and maybe they have answers, maybe they don't. But I do know this: the secret things belong unto the Lord our God. And there's things that you don't tell us, Lord. There's things that we'll find out later on. Maybe we won't find out until eternity. But you're still God. We love you and want to honor you. And Lord, we want to be a blessing and a help to this dear family. Hearts are heavy. A lot of questions. And Lord, so we need your great grace at this particular time. May you bestow it upon the family. bestowed on anyone who needs that grace. May they receive it. We love you and want to honor you with our lives. Great grace upon us. In Jesus' name, amen.
This time I'm going to invite Travis's brother, Donnie, to come and to share his words with us this afternoon.
Well, it's great to see so many beautiful and wonderful faces here. And we're going to talk about a lot of amazing memories that we've all had with Travis, an amazing person. We're going to cry together. We're going to laugh together because that's exactly what Travis would want us to do today. The darkest nights are followed by the brightest mornings. My brother, my best friend, the one who opened my eyes to the truth so many years ago. Travis Budinsky wants us to shine our light brighter than ever before, and that is what I am going to do. During these intense days and nights of grief, I could hear my brother saying, "Get up, the best is yet to come. I will see you when you get here. Now accomplish your life mission on this earth." I've asked myself, what does my brother want from me? How does he want me to live? Who does he want me to become? Travis wants me to be happy. He wants me to smile. He wants me to love. He wants me to follow Jesus Christ, to take care of our family. He wants me to help others through pain and suffering. He wants me to learn harder, dream harder, work harder than ever before. He wants me to continue strong in my ministry. And in honor of my brother and knowing that one day I will see him again, which is a day I am so incredibly excited for, I am choosing to get up and live the life the way my amazing brother would want me to live it. I truly believe many of you also know that this is how Travis would answer these same questions if you asked them. Death for a Christian is simply moving from one place to another. I want to read from 1 Thessalonians 4, specifically verses 13 and 14. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, asleep referring to those who have died, that ye sorrow not, sorrow referring to the grief that we're all experiencing today. Even as others which have no hope. But if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. The Apostle Paul is encouraging those in Christ that they will see their loved ones again. This is our hope. And this is not a hope as in, oh, well, hopefully my coffee tastes good this morning, or hopefully my favorite football or soccer or baseball team wins the big game tonight. No, this is a guarantee. We will be reunited with our loved ones. That is a guarantee. Notice Paul did not say to not sorrow or grieve. He simply said to not grieve like those with no hope. We have that hope. We have that guarantee. We don't grieve like those with no hope, but we do grieve. And so I want to say, it's okay to not be okay. It's okay to not be okay. When Jesus went to be with Mary and Martha after the death of their brother, Lazarus, Jesus wept. And this isn't just, well, I'm a little sad, a couple tears. No, he wept. He grieved like we do today. Let me repeat that. Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, he grieved. And yet Jesus was just about to resurrect Lazarus from the dead, which he did. What an amazing miracle. And so we can grieve. It's okay to not be okay. It's just not okay to stay that way. Travis does not want us to stay that way. He is victorious, and he wants us to be victorious as well. We may be in our darkest moment. I know this has been the most difficult time of my life. The pain at times has felt unbearable. I've asked a lot of questions. But I can tell you again what Travis would say. Get up. The best is yet to come. I'll see you when you get here. Travis had a mission in this world, and I can tell you he accomplished that mission. And for that, he has great reward. I know this, and I am incredibly proud of him. When it comes to life from this temporal vantage point, it's not about quantity, but about quality. And Travis accomplished so much during his life. He lived to serve, he lived to love, he lived to create a beautiful family. Travis served in the army where he grew both physically and spiritually. Travis is truly a superhero. He did not just serve in the army, he excelled in the army. One of the soldiers that he was with messaged me just last night, and he sent me pictures and talked about just how awesome Travis was. He was that man that you wanted to have on your side. He excelled in all the fitness exercises that they did, the competitions. He really is viewed as a superhero. He's the strongest person I know. He knew what he wanted in life. He excelled in fitness. He excelled in his faith. He met and married a beautiful Christian woman, Kaylee. He made his parents and his older brother proud. He reaped life everlasting. You could live until you're 100. But without striving to do that which is important, without striving to reap life everlasting, what is it for? Jesus Christ, the name above all names, God manifest in the flesh, a name that it would be nearly impossible to find somebody who's never heard of it, lived on this earth for 33 years. And he accomplished more than anybody. I could name countless names of men and women all throughout history who lived 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, and accomplished amazing things that have left an echo throughout history and an echo throughout eternity. Travis has two beautiful children with another beautiful child on the way. What an amazing reward. What an amazing accomplishment. Travis has given our parents the greatest reward. Three grandchildren, which makes six in total, to keep my parents, to give them, who I love so deeply, endless fun and joy. Travis knew what was important in life, and he sought those things. A few of those things being service, love, family, faith, God. Travis accomplished so much, and I am so proud of him. And so I want to repeat that. It's not about quantity, it's about quality. And the quality of Travis's life and spirit was amazing, truly amazing. Travis and I would talk on the phone nearly every night when he was in the army. I cherish those moments. We would talk sometimes for hours about all things. We would debate, we would get passionate, we would discuss origins, which I wasn't necessarily the most interested in at that time, but he really opened my eyes. We had some life-changing conversations. And again, I cherish every second my brother Travis and I got to spend together. Those phone calls really changed my life. I was stubborn, very stubborn. Travis was diligent, very diligent. Confident, most faithful man I know. And he convinced me of the truth. Travis is the reason for what I do in ministry. And he has a legacy in that. He has an echo throughout eternity. Travis and I shared so many amazing memories. We were best friends since day one. I've been thinking about all the memories that we had as a kid, just so many different memories coming back to me with how much fun we had and staying up all night when my mom would tell us to go to bed, but we refused because we were having too much fun, and now I see my beautiful children do that as well, Jude and Faith. And I cherish these moments, and I will cherish them for the rest of my life. We were also workout bros. We were competitive, very competitive, but this was a healthy competitiveness. It helped us push ourselves to new levels. And I am proud of my brother to say that he surpassed me. He reached impressive heights, both physically and spiritually. Those of my friends that are here today, Travis's friends that we worked out together, we'd go to the gym and he just had this incredible Hulk strength. And he would pick up that bench press, three plates on each side, and he'd do it like nothing. A true superhero. We shared endless laughs together, those kinds of uncontrollable laughs that hurt your sides and you'll never forget. I can still hear his laugh today. I go back in our Facebook messages and listen to the audios that we sent back and forth to each other, which is why we live in such an amazing time where the memory lives on through pictures, audios, videos. We both love Lord of the Rings. Travis taught me so much about the amazing Christian themes found all throughout the Lord of the Rings trilogy. At first, I thought I could never watch Lord of the Rings again. It'll be too painful. But now I'm seeing the gratitude and the gift in grief. And I look forward to watching that beautiful trilogy again and sharing those tears. Travis and I would frequently talk about a lot of the epic moments in that trilogy and some of the memorable quotes and a couple here that come to mind that I know he loved and still loves. In Lord of the Rings, Fellowship of the Ring, all hope seemed like it was lost. They were in their darkest times, and Frodo said that he might not be able to bear this pain, bear his mission. And Gandalf said, "So do all who live to see such times. But that is not for them to decide. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given to us." And Trav knew what he had to do with his time. He had a mission, and he accomplished that mission. We all get scars. We all get marks. If you don't have a scar, just keep living. You'll get a scar. But the choice is whether or not we're going to look at that scar as a scar of defeat or a scar of victory. And I choose to look at this scar as a scar of victory, a scar of growth, both physically, spiritually, because that's what Travis wants. And so again, all we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given to us. Tomorrow's not promised. Travis is the strongest man I know, and that goes spiritually, physically, and this is a wake-up call that tomorrow's not promised. Somebody as strong as Travis, as amazing as Travis, can go to be with the Lord after he's accomplished this mission here. And so it just goes to show that life is just a drop of water in an ocean of eternity. Travis was an expert at many things. And again, an expert at Tolkien mythology, as we're discussing here, Lord of the Rings. If you wanted to know about all the Christian themes in that epic trilogy, Travis was your go-to guy. Travis and I love deep movies. Movies that make you think and make you feel. Movies that change you, drive you to be a better person. We spent endless hours discussing the themes and deeper meanings of these movies. Wesley, wherever you are, my brother, There he is. He knows. Big fan of Lord of the Rings as well, and we would just spend countless unlimited hours discussing the deep things of this. And at times, we would debate. We would debate what movie trilogies were the best, which trilogies were the greatest. And even though I would sometimes be difficult and stubborn and suggest a trilogy besides Lord of the Rings being the best, such as The Dark Knight, perhaps, I'd always end up falling back to Lord of the Rings. Travis always won those debates. And I had to admit defeat. Just like he won the most important debate years and years ago when we would discuss for hours and hours the topic of origins as he was in the army. Travis was the only person I couldn't beat in a debate. Well, that might also include my wife. I am going to cherish every single amazing memory that I have with my brother. This includes all the vacations we took with the family growing up, all the camping trips and endless laughs, videos that we look back on. Actually, we just recently set up the VHS system and pulled out all of the old videos and just had so many laughs together, all of us, Travis included, watching all the videos with Grandma. And time flies, but those memories feel like they were just yesterday. One video we were watching must have been one of our first birthday parties at McDonald's. Everybody was there. All the family was there. And
including dads.
Yeah, including everybody. Yeah. And these are memories that I will never forget. The times, the nights that we were kids playing around, laughing, wrestling, my mom telling us to get to bed, as I said. These are some of the most vivid memories that I have today. And I look forward to making more in the next life with him, where he awaits in glory. The Bible says, "For God hath not given to us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind." And Travis wants us today to have a sound mind, to celebrate his life and to celebrate his accomplishments. The Bible says, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him and he shall direct thy paths." We need to trust in the Lord and honor Travis for his accomplishments. Why does death feel so strange? Why does it feel so unnatural? Why does it feel so final? We know the answer to these questions. This is because God has put eternity into our hearts. Eternity is not found in this temporal world. Travis knew this. He knows this. This world is just passing by. The body will die, and our spirit will live on. That's why the Apostle Paul, one of the greatest Christians who ever lived, said, "Who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" He was eager to depart and be with the Lord, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. What a beautiful thing. No pain, no suffering, just in a moment, in an instant. But he said, for our sake, he'll remain, he'll minister for us. I know I will see him again. I didn't lose my brother. And I can't wait for that day, that hope that brings us back to 1 Thessalonians 4, that guarantee that we will see our loved ones again. Travis is in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, our hope is not in this world, it is in heaven. Now I have something from Kaylee, Travis's wife, that I would like to read. From Kaylee. "I feel I have so much to say, yet no words to say at all. I thought I'd spend the rest of my life with my soulmate, Travis. But instead, he spent the rest of his life with me. As we remember and celebrate Travis's 32 years of life, I want to emphasize the person he purely, genuinely, and unashamedly was, and the loving heart he had for his family and the Lord. Travis's spirit was meek and kind and gentle. He was often referred to as a gentle giant. On the outside, you see a tall, brawny, tough-looking man. But when you get to know him, his compassionate, friendly, and loving nature shines through. As a husband, he was all God prepared him to be. He loved me beyond measure, greater than he loved himself, Ephesians 5:28. He was loyal and committed from the moment we met. Travis was so intentional in the way he loved me and took carrying my heart in his hands seriously and fragilely. He was a leader in many ways, but as a husband, he always led me to seek the Lord. Every night we would pray together, we often read our Bibles together, and he actively searched for the right church for us to attend, Crossway Baptist. There was no greater friend than the friend I had in my husband, and no better soulmate. We were so blessed by God that he could be home with his family while simultaneously providing us for us financially. He took great care of us and all our needs. We were all together 24/7, and I will forever cherish the beauty and rarity of that. Travis became a dad when our daughter Arwen was born on April 8th, 2020. I watched the tears fall down his face as he welcomed his little girl into this world. The first picture taken of Arwen was of her holding Travis's finger with her whole hand, and she's been wrapped around it ever since. The bond he created with our daughter was everything I prayed for. He was a very fun, loving, goofy, and present father. Over the past few months, Arwen and Travis had been spending so much one-on-one time together and really strengthened their relationship. What once was always about mommy was now all about daddy, even to the point that she specifically wanted him only to wipe her bottom after going to the bathroom. I remember asking him, "How do you like being the favorite?" He got the son he always wanted when sweet Titus was born. I spent essentially every day over at the house just seeing the family. You really realize how important family and friends are in times like this. And sweet baby Titus just looks exactly like Travis. And so when I'm sitting there with Titus fighting, battling for a hug, which I'll get one day, I see Travis and I see me in our son, Gabriel. And so we have me. I oftentimes look at Gabe and say, "You know, you're me." And Titus is Travis. What was once always about mommy was now all about daddy. He got the son he always wanted when sweet Titus was born. They share a birthday month and got to celebrate together on his first birthday. Titus is almost an exact replica of his daddy. And every time I look at his little face, I will forever see Trav. This last January, God surprised us with a third baby. There are so many reasons why this is a blessing. And though I have to go on with my pregnancy and deliver our baby without Travis here, God will remind me of all those wonderful reasons. If you only remember one thing about Travis, I hope it's this: that he loved the Lord with all his heart, and he did his best at making sure his family and friends would one day join him in heaven. He brought God great glory and honor every time he shared the gospel. He has led many souls to salvation while he was here on earth. He has planted countless seeds in the hearts of those that I can only pray will come to fruition one day, and that those people will receive Christ and salvation. His reward in heaven is great. And as a Christian wife, I could not be more proud of him. Because of his strong faith and because he was saved, I have the hope of being with him again. And so does anyone else who believes on the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us that there is no mourning or sadness or pain or suffering in heaven, and that every tear will be wiped away. Though I am devastated to not have my husband here with me, I am rejoicing for him, knowing he is in pure bliss. If God told me I could have the option of bringing him back to earth, I wouldn't bring him back. How selfish of me would it be to make him leave the glory land where he only feels joy? I thank God Travis is with him now for eternity, and I will see him soon. I will end this here. This is what I believe to be Travis's life quote. If you meet me and forget me, you have lost nothing. But if you meet Jesus Christ and forget him, you have lost everything. He never cared whether or not you liked him or remembered him, but only that you'd meet Jesus and spend eternity with him. And I can attest to that. Travis was popular, is popular, but it was never a popularity contest to Travis. Just another amazing thing about him. I'm now going to invite Wesley up to share some words. And after Wesley, anybody, no pressure, of course, is welcome to come up and share anything that they'd like to. And then I'll end it with some words.
Hello, everyone. I'm Wes Cunning. Travis Budinsky, or Trav as we knew him, was my friend since we were 4 years old. Our bond started in kindergarten and grew into nearly three decades of shared adventures and memories. An early memory I cherish is being at Trav's house and eating a full course meal his mother Debbie made for us, as she did every night I can remember. Carl, Travis's father, and Donnie, Travis's brother, were also at the dinner table with us. I loved eating meals with the Budinskys. I would imagine I was their third son. Debbie always made sure her boys were full and fed healthy. I remember Debbie teaching Travis and I the negative effects of aspartame when we were probably seven. Every drink of pop I ever had for the rest of my life was accompanied by a feeling of guilt and Debbie's voice in my head, "There's aspartame in that, Wes." Another memory was when Travis and I challenged Travis's older brother, Donnie, to a wrestling match in the winter at the corner of the street they lived on, Aurora Drive, in Forest Glade. We were probably about eight at this time. I charged at Donnie, and he easily threw me to the ground. Travis, seeing me on the ground, then charged Donnie, and I watched the brothers wrestle together for a long minute before Donnie emerged victorious. Snow dripping from both their faces, both tired after a hard-fought battle, but in the end, laughing and embracing each other on the walk home. Eventually, the Budinskys added an above-ground pool to the backyard. Travis, Donnie, our friend Vince, and I would swim for hours and hours until Debbie would announce, "Come on in, kids, dinner's ready." We would quickly dry ourselves off and race inside to refuel. I can still see their childhood dog, Lacey, licking Travis's face like it was yesterday. Lacey was a Shih Tzu. Travis absolutely adored his pup. He used to call Lacey his little smoochy smooch. When we were probably about 12 years old, Travis and I had a big debate. It became so heated, I still remember it to this day. I was saying that humans were no different than animals, and that, in fact, we were the same as them. This was obvious to me, but insulting to Travis. I was confused at just how upset my claim of us being animals made Travis. We're not animals, Wes. We're completely different. Looking back, I realized this was an early sign of a strong faith that would blossom later in his life. The meaning of life, according to Travis as a child, was simple. We got to meet good women who will marry us and have kids. At this time, Travis and I were more interested in video games than girls, but regardless, this was his idea of a complete life. Travis had an innocent wisdom about him. My family and I moved to Oshawa, Ontario when I was 19, when I was 14. At 19, I finally moved back to Windsor, only Travis wasn't there waiting for me. Travis had changed while I was away, from a shy, introverted boy to a 6'3" muscle-bound man who was living in Shiloh, Manitoba, serving his country and the Canadian Reg Force Military Artillery Division at the tender age of 19. When he completed his grueling artillery course, he called me. This was the proudest moment of his young life. The military instilled confidence in him, fearlessness. It was at this time he began talking about his love and belief in Jesus Christ. In Travis's shadow at 24, I joined the Canadian military. While away, we talked on the phone often, at times every day. Then something happened. I remember when he first mentioned her. I asked him, "What's her name?" And he responded, "Kaylee." I said, "So, what's she like?" With a snarky voice, he responded, "You wouldn't like her, Wes. She's got morals." Travis always had a way with words. He said, "She's a beautiful Christian woman." That statement to Travis wasn't just a description. This was the highest honor Travis could ever describe a woman with. Eventually, Travis chose a subtle way of asking Kaylee to marry him, by skydiving out of a plane with a ring in his pocket. She said yes. The wedding was in Michigan, and I flew from Alberta to be there. It was perfect. I remember Carl helping Travis and I put our suits on properly before we hit the road, straightening our ties and solving the mystery of how these clips strapped to our pants. Travis was nervous. He wasn't nervous about marrying Kaylee. That he couldn't wait for, but for the spotlight to be on him the entire day. Travis never needed this kind of attention. I remember standing beside him at the altar and waiting for his face to turn red, like I knew it would, and it did, until he saw Kaylee. Then awkwardness turned into intense focus. He even danced their first dance in a way where I thought to myself, wow, Trav can actually dance. In the years following, Travis and Kaylee would welcome two beautiful children into the world named Arwen and Titus. To Debbie and Carl, I need you to know that Travis many, many times. Uttered the phrase, "We had the perfect childhood." I can't begin to tell you how much time as we got older, he and I would spend reminiscing about our many memories as kids. You gave him comfort, safety, effort, and laughter. I want to thank you both for allowing us to be innocent and for not burdening us with the heaviness of the world. He described you both in our adult years as the perfect parents. And if one day my children speak half as highly of me as Travis did of both of you, then I will have succeeded as a parent. Donnie, you and Travis were not just brothers, you were twins. I'll always cherish the countless memories the three of us shared. Travis told me many times how much he admired you throughout our lives. Sometimes he had a difficult time saying this to you. To Jess, Travis loved and respected you deeply. You are everything he ever hoped for Donnie and more. Kaylee, thank you. Your meeting was the result of a million prayers which started when Travis was a child. You fulfilled Travis's spoken childhood meaning of life, meeting a good woman to marry and have kids with. Travis viewed you as the perfect wife and mother. Everyone in this room loves you, and we are here for you now and forever. To Travis, I want to say thank you for sharing your life with me. Thank you for the laughter. Thank you for journeying with me all those long years, my old friend. Lastly, I'd like to say a quote from Travis's favorite movie, The Lord of the Rings, The Return of the King. In this scene, Pippin, who is one of the main characters of the film, is fighting in a great war beside his friend, a wizard named Gandalf, during the large final battle of the trilogy. This moment is tense. Hope is fading for Pippin. Fearful and saddened, it's likely this will be his end. They have an exchange of words in this moment that goes like this. A disheartened Pippin says, "I didn't think it would end this way." Gandalf responds, "End? No, the journey does not end here. Death is just another path, one that we all must take. The gray curtain of this world rolls back and all turns to silver glass, and then you see it." "See what, Gandalf?" Pippin asks. "White shores, and beyond, a far green country under a swift sunrise." Soothed by these words, Pippin says, "Well, that isn't so bad." "No," says Gandalf. "No, it isn't." Thank you.
Wesley, you know how to make a man cry and laugh at the same time. Can't top that. I love you, brother. Is there anybody else that would like to come up and say anything that might be on their mind or a story? Be quiet.
And they played that video for years. Remember? They'd be in the basement. They'd hit the button. I'd be watching TV. Oh my God. I had a it's too bad we don't have it anymore.
And those were in the days where we didn't have.
I said, shut up.
we had this tape recorder. We were always taping. This was before the invention of the phones where we could just record things on demand, on the spot. And Travis and I got a tape recorder. We were so excited. We were just kids, and we would record our own episodes of Pokemon. And my dad wanted at least one of us to be a Major League Baseball player. And he was my coach for years and years and years. And so many good memories playing baseball. Travis wasn't necessarily the most excited about it. But my dad would say, if you come out and you play baseball and you join the team, after every game, we're going to go buy a pack of Pokemon cards. And we did. And those moments feel like yesterday. And we still have those Pokemon cards. Yeah. Who knows? Maybe one's worth $1 million. I don't know. But some last words here that I'd like to say. As Wesley also demonstrated, beautifully so, Travis had a mission. He knew what he wanted. He accomplished that mission. He knew it was never about quantity, it was about quality. And he had that quality. Grief is a powerful friend in the face of a significant loss and unbearable pain. I didn't know it was possible to have this kind of pain. I was broken, still am broken. You don't recover from grief. It's not just this linear process where, like the flu, you got a couple symptoms, and then over the next 7 to 10 days, they get better and improve, and you feel better. You grow. You learn to build your life and design your life around this change. And I choose gratitude. This is what Travis wants me to choose. I understand what I'm grieving. The intense sadness, the waves of emotion. And I know that I will cry every single day for the rest of my life until I see Travis again. Even at the gym the other night, I was feeling a level of comfort, doing a workout, and immediately I was reminded of my gym bro, and I cried, and that's okay, because it's okay to not be okay. It's just not okay to stay that way. That's not what Trav wants. Travis wants me to choose gratitude. Yes, the waves of emotions, they're all over the place. But I also understand what I am grateful for. I am grateful that my brother and I got to spend so much time together and create so many amazing memories together. I am so grateful that I got the chance and the joy to be his big brother. I feel we made 100 years worth of memories during our time here together on this earth, and I am so grateful I will get to see him again. Gratitude gives us the opportunity to allow the natural feelings of grief to take place. It's not about stay strong, be strong. No, if you need to cry, cry. Let those organic feelings come out naturally. If I need to cry, I will cry. If I'm feeling happy, I'll be happy. Is grief a gift to all of us who have lost loved ones? I say yes, it is. It gives us the opportunity to grow stronger, to be better people, to come together, and to carry out the legacy of our loved one by honoring them in this life before meeting them again in the next. Thank you.
Actually listen to a song that was very special between Kaylee and Travis.
Soon we'll come to the end of life's journey, and perhaps we'll never meet anymore, till we gather in heaven's bright city, far away on that beautiful shore. If we never meet again this side of heaven, as we struggle through this world and its strife, there's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the side of the river of life, where the roses bloom forever, and where separation comes no more. If we never meet again this side of heaven, I will meet you on that beautiful shore. Oh, they say we shall meet by the river, where no storm clouds ever darken the sky, and they say we'll be happy in heaven, in that wonderful sweet by and by. If we never meet again this side of heaven, as we struggle through this world and its strife, there's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the side of the river of life, where the roses bloom forever, and where separation comes no more. If we never meet again this side of heaven, I will meet you on that beautiful shore.
Psalm 23 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This time I invite you to sing as you can another one of Travis's favorite hymns, Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
We at Crossway Baptist Church are very thankful to have been able to know the life of Travis Budinsky. In just a very short while of getting to know Travis and Kaylee and their family, they have been growing us on us ever so quickly. Their wonderful family, their presence here, they are a blessing to us here. Many good memories that we've been able to have. In just one of our recent services, just before Easter, we had a hymn sing together here at church, which is just simply those who have favorite hymns have the opportunity to call out a hymn that they would like for us to sing together. And on that Sunday, the hymn of Amazing Grace that we all just sang together was the hymn that Travis asked that we would sing together. You see, Travis knew who Jesus Christ was. He knew the Lord. And he knew how amazing it is that God would want to have a relationship with us, that he would want to know us, and for us to know him, and for us to live life with him in our lives. It's truly an amazing thing when you consider how undeserving we are of that kind of relationship, that kind of love. I'd like to read you a passage from the book of John that describes for us who just Jesus Christ is, who he was to Travis and what Travis would want you to know today as we grieve and as we mourn today, the hope that is found in the person of Jesus Christ as your Savior, as your Lord. Donnie has already mentioned this passage of John 11, which speaks about Jesus coming to meet some friends, close friends, friends that he had a close relationship with. Their names were Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. They're all very dear to Jesus, and Lazarus had been sick, and now he had passed away. And Martha and Mary, Lazarus's sisters, are grieving this loss. They lived in just a little town about 2 miles away from Jerusalem. It was within walking distance. You'd come out of Jerusalem and you'd go down through a valley where the Garden of Gethsemane is that Scripture speaks of. You'd pass over a mount that's called the Mount of Olives, and just on the other side was Bethany, where Lazarus with his sisters lived. Jesus is approaching this place to come and be with Martha and Mary to share in their grief that they are experiencing. And it says, now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off, and many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection and at the last day. Martha, in her grief, comes to Jesus, and she doesn't understand why. She doesn't understand why Jesus, the one who she believed had power to heal her brother, did not come and heal him before he died. Why would the one that she has known and followed for the earthly ministry of Jesus, why would Jesus, who had opened the eyes of the blind, who caused the lame to walk again, why would Jesus not allow this very close friend of Lazarus to be healed from his sickness, to be spared the grief and the sorrow? But even in the midst of her questions, Jesus does not rebuke her. Jesus does not tell her to stop. Jesus has conversation with her. And in the midst of that conversation, though Martha doesn't understand why, her faith in who Jesus is remains the same. She says, whatever you ask of God the Father in heaven, I know it will be answered. You can ask anything and it will be done. In the midst of our grief and our loss today, Jesus enters into that grief and loss as well. He's there to have conversation with those who are willing that as he comes to you, to speak with him and ask the questions, to speak to the Lord. He is there to comfort and to help us in this time. The grace that God gives through Jesus Christ is a grace that is for today. It's for living this life. It's to be able to have meaning and purpose in this life. It comes through the person of Jesus Christ. Because in the midst of this conversation, the one thing that Jesus Christ wants Martha to know in her grief is not an answer to her questions, the answers of why, but rather it is this. He says to Martha, Jesus saith unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? That if there was one question for Mary to ask herself in the midst of losing her brother, it was not why did it happen? Why didn't Jesus prevent it? It was this one question that Jesus had for her. Believest thou that I am the resurrection and the life. Jesus can answer any question that we have today. He knows the answer. But the most important thing for your heart today is to ask yourself the question that he asked to you. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life? That was the most important thing for Martha to receive in this time of her faith in Jesus Christ and who he was. Jesus, he gives amazing grace for us to be able to live in this life with the difficulties and challenges that we face. That grace is giving us power to keep on living. That grace is giving us purpose to keep on living. God still has something for you. God still has a meaning for your life in this world. Though we have faced great loss and sorrow, there is still great purpose for your life. And that purpose and that power to live that purpose out comes through Jesus Christ, because he said, I am the resurrection and the life. That means there is life to live today still because of Jesus being the life. He said, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. Believe in my purpose that I have for you. Believe in the power that I have for you to continue to live life. He says to every believer that has placed faith in Jesus Christ, it says in Hebrews 4:16, that let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. The grace that God offers to every one that has placed their faith in Jesus Christ alone for forgiveness of their sins and eternal life is that you can come to the Lord today and ask for grace in a time of need. And he has power for you to continue living life. He has a purpose for you to continue living life. That is the promise that each of us who know Christ as Savior to claim today. The story as it continues, Martha goes back to the home. Her sister Mary is still there. And she tells Mary that Jesus has come. And she tells Mary that Jesus is calling for you to come. And so Mary gets up and she goes to the place where Jesus is. And Jesus has come to the tomb, the grave, where Lazarus has been buried, where his body lies. And it had been there for 4 days now. And so as Mary and Martha come back to that place where their brother is lying in the grave, they come before Jesus. And it says here in this passage, when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hast been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled, and said, Where have ye laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, Behold, how he loved him. And some of them said, Could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus therefore again, groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. It was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. Jesus said, Take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he hath been dead 4 days. Jesus saith unto her, Said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee, thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou heardest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he had thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus saith unto them, Loose him, and let him go. Then many of the Jews which came to Mary and had seen the things which Jesus did, they believed on him. But some of them went their ways to the Pharisees and told them what things Jesus had done. You see, for all who have called upon Christ for salvation and through Christ alone, by God's grace, through faith, there is the hope of grace to live eternal life. You see, you and I recognize that we need grace to keep living this earthly life. And God promises to give us grace to live this earthly life if we will listen to him, if we'll talk with him, if we'll come to him. But more than any grace that we need to continue living this earthly life, what is much more important and what Jesus seeks to give to these people in this story is that you need grace to live eternal life. You need something that you cannot earn yourself. You need something that is far beyond your reach and capacity to obtain. You need something you could never pay for. You need something that you could never be good enough for in order to live for all of eternity. And Jesus is the one who seeks to give us grace to live for eternity. It's so much, the life that is to come, that it is, again, eternal, something that has no end. It goes on so much longer than this vapor of a life that we live in today. Jesus came and he wept. Lazarus rose from the grave. Some believed in who Jesus was, that he was not just a mere man, but he was God come down, manifested in our flesh. But some didn't. And they went on to the religious leaders who began to make plans to murder Jesus. You see, this miracle of grace that God brought to this family of Martha, Mary, Lazarus, this miracle of grace that he did in their life was the start of his death. That things became in motion that Jesus would be betrayed into the hands of his enemies. His enemies would wrongfully accuse him. They would take him and bring him before the governor of their day, and he would be sentenced unjustly to death. And he would die shamefully on a cross in public for things he had never done, for claims that were not true. And as much as Mary and Martha thought it was not fair that their brother had died, Jesus should have saved him. The greatest injustice that has ever taken place on this planet in all of mankind's history is that the Son of God, perfect without any wrongdoing, he never had a wrong thought, he never said a wrong word, he never did anything ill towards anyone. It was that the perfect Son of God died on a cross. He didn't deserve to die. If anyone deserved to live, it was the Son of God. And yet he went there in order to bring grace for us to live for all eternity. When Jesus died on the cross, he was not dying for himself. It was not an event that took place and was long forgotten. It was something that when he died upon that cross there, he was dying for me and he was dying for you. The Bible says that the soul that sinneth, it shall die. Death is unnatural. Death does not belong into this world. But we have brought death. By one man, sin came into the world, and death by sin, so that all have sinned, and all will one day die. The evidence that we are all sinners is that we all one day die. The Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We have things that are important in this life, that are good in this life. Here at Crossway, things like baptism are important. Following the Lord in believer's baptism. We had communion just before Easter. Communion is important. It is important for us to do good to one another and to all men. But there is never enough good in your baptism, in observing the Lord's Supper table, or of doing good to others that is good enough to be perfect. You need something that is without sin. Something that has been pure from its beginning. And the only thing that has come into this life that is pure from its beginning, that has no beginning at all, is God, is Jesus Christ. That when he died on the cross, He was the only one that could take man's sin and bear it upon himself, because only he was righteous without sin. Only he could purchase that pardon that we have towards a holy God. Jesus said, "He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him." See, the justice of God, the justice of Jesus Christ, his righteousness, his holiness, who he is, declares that man must die for his sins, his disobedience towards a holy God. But the love and mercy of Jesus Christ says, "I'll pay for those sins. I'll die for those sins. I'll die the death that mankind deserves to die. I'll go in their place." That's grace. That's something that we don't deserve. We justly deserve to die, but Jesus says, "I don't want you to die. I want to redeem you." And he did so by the shedding of his blood on a cross for you. The Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. There's no amount of good that can do to right the wrongs. It is only the shedding of blood, but it had to be a perfect lamb. It had to be one without sin. And only Jesus could die to remove the sins of the world. That whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The Bible says that thou shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead. He didn't stay dead in the grave. After 3 days, he rose again, proving he was who he said he was. And he blazed a trail straight through death, that all who should believe on Christ and follow Christ through death should not enter into eternal separation from God and what the Bible describes as a lake of fire that burns with brimstone, but rather entering into death, they should follow Christ who went into death before them into eternal life, to be present with the Lord, to be in heaven. See, not everyone goes to heaven, but everyone can go to heaven through the way of Jesus Christ. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." And his question that is of greatest importance for those who have called upon the Lord for salvation, for those perhaps today that have yet to make that decision, is not why. One day in heaven, we'll understand it better. But the most important question in this moment is, do I believe that Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life? Well, I don't understand how he will make everything from this point right to the point of being in heaven, but that's where his grace comes in to get us there. And what gets us from this life into the next, into heaven, is his grace of salvation. Now, if you owed someone $500,000 and you had no means to pay that, you had no way of conjuring up that enormous amount of money to pay off your debt, but someone who knew you, but you didn't know them, someone who cared for you and loved you, but you didn't know who they were and you didn't love them, came to you and said, "Here's a check for $500,000 and gave it to you and said, "Go pay your debt." That would be grace. And that's what Jesus has done for every one of us. He's given us what we don't deserve. But what we have to do is receive what he's given to us. And he promises that those who come to him, asking and calling upon him for forgiveness of sins and eternal life, he will no wise cast out. He invites all the world, because he so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And so Travis, this was his faith. And what he wants you to remember today in your grief and in your sorrow, the question that Travis would want you to ask yourself: do I believe that Jesus is the resurrection and life? He's life for this life, this earthly life, but he is life for the life that is to come. Do you know Jesus Christ? Today is a day to call upon his name. Today is a day to be saved from sin and to live a life of purpose with power. That's his power. That's his grace given to us. Let's close in a word of prayer together. God, we are thankful for the testimony of Travis. Lord, the life that he brought into our lives by his personality and character and the man that he was. But God, we thank you most of all for the person of Jesus Christ that Travis knew and that his life points us towards. God, how I pray every soul here today would know Jesus Christ as their life. Life for this life, but life for the life to come by believing in him who died for us in our place to forgive us of a debt we could never repay. God, help us in this time, we pray. In Jesus' name I ask, amen. Would you think on that man, Jesus Christ, whom Travis so loved and had given his life to, as we sing this song in closing today, the old rugged cross.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. On that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
In just a moment, we are going to dismiss, and everyone is welcome to have a bite to eat here, and you may want to visit more with the family and with one another, and so we have some food that's been prepared to help facilitate that and for you to be able to enjoy. If you haven't found already, the washrooms are just off to this wall over here, men on this side of the partition and ladies on the other side, there for your use. And as we dismiss in this time, I just want to mention again that if you have questions about this one Jesus Christ that Travis had, his hope for not just this life, but the life to come. If you question about what it means to receive Christ for salvation, you don't understand, it doesn't make sense, I would love to be able to have a conversation with you about the gospel. And I'll be available just on the side here, and you feel free to come by if I can be a help to you in any way. You also have many folks around you here that would love to talk further with you about those things and tell you about the hope, an everlasting hope, a lasting hope that Travis had and knows today in reality that is sure because of what our God has given to us by his grace. And so we'll close this time in a word of prayer, and then you may be dismissed to make your way to the back. I'll invite you to go down this side of the columns and make your way through the table in that way. You can go into the fellowship room, or you may want to come back out to the auditorium, whatever you're comfortable doing, and to enjoy that time together. Let's close in a word of prayer here. Heavenly Father, we come to a close of a service like this, Lord, and we thank you, Lord, that when we have done all that we can do, Lord, you take up what we cannot do. And Lord, we have committed the life of Travis into your hands, and we hold on to those promises of your soon and coming return, whether you should come for us by the sound of the trumpet or whether we should go through death's door ourselves. Lord, we look forward to that time of seeing you face to face and to be reunited with Travis and other loved ones who have received Christ. Lord, how I pray that you would be with the family, that you be with Kaylee, that you would comfort her, strengthen her, give her your purpose and power as she continues to live life. Help us to be that support and that presence that she needs in her life. Comfort and strengthen family, Lord, as we look forward to that time of the confidence that we have by your word that we shall be reunited again to be with you and Travis and loved ones. God, bless this food, bless the fellowship that we're about to have, and help us, God, to live the life that you have given and designed for us to live with purpose and with power by your grace. God, we thank you for these things and commit this all now to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.